King of the worshipers. Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi everyone, I'm Gary Null. Today we're going to hear from a study from Macquarie University in Australia, published in PLOS One, that a healthier diet directly reduced depression in a randomized controlled trial. That's good news. We have a lot more following that as well. Then today's going to be Environmental Day. I'm going to share extemporaneously, I haven't written out anything, what we could do, should do, and must do, but what will end up being done. This is going to be a hypothesis, but a constructive one. I'm going to share with you my insights on the environmental movement, which organizations I believe, and this is my personal opinion, are legitimate and which are not, and which things that we're talking about in the media are likely to happen, which are absolutely not going to happen. So that's going to come today, plus some new information that no one's been made aware of yet. Also, I have some audio clips, interesting ones. For example, How to Escape Education's Death Valley by Ken Robinson, a really cool guy. You're going to enjoy it because he has a wonderful way, almost a Will Rogers way, of blending common sense with some of our current problems and changing our perception about education. Also, Hillary Clinton really celebrated the defeat of Gaddafi. And we're going to play an 11-second clip, but then I'm going to do my challenge to her on that. Also, I saw where Ellen DeGeneres is having some slight challenge to her for having said that she's close friends with George Bush and hung out with him at the Dallas Cowboy. And you can have whatever views you want. It's her life. She has a right to any friends she wants. But then I saw that Mark Ruffalo, the actor, had some specific point, and I'm going to focus on that for a moment. In fact, it was just, I'll get into that when I come to that part of our program. And if time permits, is technology addiction a myth? This is from a reporter from the BBC. Very interesting perspective. So I have a lot of different things to share today, and we always begin with the latest on health. Most of us have encountered young adults with depression, and often their diet is usually unhealthy. In fact, I just counseled a person yesterday, the daughter of someone who I know, and they don't always have symptoms of depression until they eat. And there's when a lot of this depression begins to manifest. Well, this is what they're finding. And while much research has shown that eating a healthy diet rich in fruits and vegetables, things we talk about all the time in the show, a Mediterranean diet, a vegan diet is the ideal, is associated with reduced risk of depression, there have been very few randomized controlled trials directly examining the links between the two, including for young adults who are establishing health patterns and are also at higher risk of depression. They took 76 university students, 17 to 35 years of age, and who had moderate to high level of depression symptoms, and following a poor diet based upon the Australian Guide to Healthy Eating, which is high in processed foods, sugars, and saturated fats. And they were randomized to participate either in, you know, regular diet, which they've been eating, like an American diet, very unhealthy, or a healthier diet. And so The outcome was that those that were on a regular diet still remained depressed, same level, but those who changed to a healthier plant-based diet had substantial improvements in depression symptoms. And that healthy change could last up to 3 months. So that's good, which in one way is good for those people who are not consistent. So even people who make an effort but don't always follow up are still benefiting. Also from the University of Maranhão, which is in Brazil, published in the Journal of Acupuncture and Meridian Studies, acupuncture can be an effective treatment for chronic headaches. And the researchers recruited patients suffering from chronic pain and divided them into 2 groups. One group received acupuncture treatment, and the other group received a sham acupuncture, in which the needles were inserted into a device at the same points used in group one, but there was no actual acupuncture. One group that got the actual acupuncture, substantial improvement. So, based upon these findings, the researchers concluded that acupuncture can be considered an auxiliary treatment for chronic headaches because it can reduce the intensity of pain, the number of crises, and the quantity of analgesics used, and improve the quality of life of patients with this painful condition. That is important. From the University of Iowa, researchers at the National Jewish Health and University of Iowa together have identified a compound in human breast milk that fights infections by harmful bacteria while allowing beneficial bacteria to thrive. How perfect is that? Breast milk. So human breast milk has more than 200 times the amount of what is called glycerol, monolaurate, that is found, let's say, in cow's milk. An infant formula has 0. So this very important substance they found, which is called, it's gly, G-L-Y, cerol, C-E-R-O-L, mono, M-O-N-O, laurate, L-A-U-R-A-T-E, glycerol monolaurate. That is very terrific for the developing baby. And that means that human breast milk can strongly inhibit pathogenic bacteria. And this was published in this joint study by professors of pediatrics in the scientific reports. So breast milk wins out again. From the Saro Institute of Molecular Medicine at Temple University, stomach cancer cells are halted dead with whole tomato extract. So what's the takeaway message? If you're concerned about stomach cancer or your overall health of digestion, this news will be of great interest to you. The Mediterranean diet has become regarded as highly beneficial to overall health, heart, brain, musculature, lungs, liver, kidneys, and also helping you to maintain ideal weight and a reduced risk of cancer, plus many other chronic disease conditions. And one of the staples of this diet is tomatoes. Now, you talk about tomatoes and all the different ways they can taste and be marinated and prepared. You got it. Look, on everyone's list of places they must visit in their life are the Mediterranean countries. Both the Eastern Mediterranean and the Western Mediterranean, completely different in their diet, their attitude, much of their culture is different, and we need to expose ourselves and we need to expose our children to other cultures. It's absolutely essential. And what you're going to find is in these other countries, there's just so much kindness and love. I remember going with my brothers and Franco Pantone and Chris Calipi, because they spoke fluent Italian, because Franco's from Italy, and going into a nunnery. And we went to the nunnery for a simple reason. because the day before we were on the island of Capri. I've been to Italy in the summer, and it's great, especially if you're driving down the Mediterranean coast. I remember it was just magic stopping in a little restaurant and having all the food prepared from scratch. The older woman who owned this place, I'm guessing she was in her 70s or 80s, she went out back, and I walked out back. I wanted to see what she was doing. And she has all these flower beds, and she was picking herbs that she was then going to use in the dishes she was making from scratch. And this place was known that you can't rush and go there. You have to really take your time. It might take 2 to 3 hours for a meal. But there was a field across the street, and I went over, and it was in sat under a tree, and I leaned back. And mind you, there you can look out at the Mediterranean, but you close your eyes and you hear this clacking sound, and that's the wheat chaffs hitting against each other in the breeze. Oh my goodness. And immediately into my mind comes of thinking about farmers who at that time of day would have been in their siesta, putting down their scythes and sitting and opening their basket and having their lunch. And just feeling the warm August breeze. If you've never been there, put it on your list. But also, if you want a real experience, ask one of these small restaurants, can you just watch them? And say you'd like to learn. And it's how methodical they can do things, which tomato they pick up and they hold it, because they know if it has a certain weight, means that the sugars have matured in the tomato. Same thing with a peach. And that's why every single item they're serving you is just to perfection. And how long to grill something, or what temperature the olive oil should be, and which type of garlic to use, black garlic, regular garlic, elephant garlic, whether to roast the garlic and then mash it up and put some white beans in it. All these things go on in that restaurant. Well, being a chef and owning 3 vegan restaurants, including the most famous gourmet vegan restaurant in American history, the Fertile Earth. And that was up at near Columbia University, 108th and Broadway. And then Gary's place over on Columbus. Being in the kitchen and selecting the food, making sure that everything's right, and you know that these people are doing it right. And if you have any ailment at all, and you tell them, suddenly there are things being picked and put in there that are historically used, the herbs and spices and seasonings and oils. Because after all, that's what they've learned, passed it down. In any case, there's a lot of different tomatoes. Well, those tomatoes are a big deal. And I like tomatoes that are slightly sautéed and then put an orange mist over it, regular oranges. You spray it. You make a reduction, and with a reduction you simply take your oranges and put them in a blender until it's juiced, and then you put that into a little jar and you put a little spritzer on it, and that way you can spritz that on a salad or a dish. And talk about something delicious, spray lemon juice or lime juice on your brown rice. It changes the whole mouthfeel. And so this woman put lemon juice on the tomatoes and sprinkled some sea salt on it, handed it to me, and I'm sitting out there in the field. Doesn't get better for me than that, because my nature is to be close to nature. But anyhow, the idea... Oh, so we from there we went to Capri. Capri is very pretty. About 45 minutes, you're on a boat and go out to this island. Not a big island, historically important. And then at night, we're the only ones in the dining room. Huge, beautiful dining room. And they have everything set out on little plates. And so, you know, we go over and no one's really serving us. We're serving ourselves. And so I'm thinking, I don't see a menu. Now, there's my little mind thinking, what is this going to cost me? Because guess who pays every time I go out with my brothers and friends, right? And one friend has never picked up a pen. This bothers me. I keep telling him, he's the cheapest guy in history, my buddy. And then he just laughs. So anyhow, I'm talking about like 20 feet a table going back across the room. And they have the beautiful eggplant done four or five different ways. And they have, for them, they had fish, fresh caught, and then they had salads of all different types. So I get, as I normally do, I eat very small. But they don't. They're pounding on. And then the next day we go down in the basement and at this place to get it. Two of us did. And to get this volcanic deep cleanser. Now, I never had a volcanic cleanser. I wasn't even sure what it was about. And they, you know, they have us get on our trunks and we lay down. And then they wrap this. It looks like a sarcophagus, what it looked like. I had to free my buddy out. And we're laying back. And they've got this linen that's wrapped around it. You look like a mummy. You can't move. And then they load on this volcanic mud that's hot. And then the woman, as she leaves. And so we're there, and about 2 minutes later, my buddy says, "Are you hot?" I said, "Yeah, this is very hot." He says, "This is really hot." And I said, "Well, just breathe deep and relax." About another minute and 2 minutes later, he says, "I'm on fire." I said, "You're not on fire. Both of us have the same temperature. I'm fine." And then he starts freaking out. Oh, my God. He starts screaming for the woman. And he goes, I'm looking at him. And she finally, 10 minutes later, comes back, and he's just going nuts. So she shovels off the mud, and he gets out. His body's red, yeah. And he runs in the shower. And, yeah, Chris, that was an experience, wasn't it? Anyhow, so I get upstairs. It's time for us to leave. And I get the bill. It's $1,200. I'm thinking $1,200. We got here at 6 o'clock last night. We had a little meal. And it's $1,200? Yeah, because every single one of those items that we ate, every single one, they charge for it. And a lot. So just to always look at the menu and always know what something's going to cost when you go to these countries. I'm not suggesting they try to rip us off. It was a wonderful experience. It's just, you know, had I known that everything was a la carte, I would have said, remember, fellas, every single dish. So limit what you eat. You're not starving to death. You can say that to your brother and buddies. And then they'll accuse me of trying to starve him on the, Gary's so damn cheap, he didn't even, you know, want us to get filled. In any case, the next night, I said, well, we're not going to that place we intended to go up on top of that mountain. Franco, take us to some place nice, but inexpensive. So he takes us to a nunnery. Yeah, a real nunnery. All nuns, and they all sit, everything is communal eating, and we all sit at this table. And they bring us some really, I mean, look, maybe at some point in modern history someone has had a bad meal in Italy, but I would doubt it. I mean, Italy and France, every meal is spectacular. I mean, it's just, and that's not the same as Italian-American eating. That's altogether a different beast. But it was all healthy, and it was very delicious, and it was not bland, but it was not terribly seasoned. But here we are, we finished eating, and it's 6 o'clock because they eat early, and then they do their prayers, and that didn't go over. Well, fellas, what do you want to do tonight? How about praying? I don't think so. So we finally go to these rooms, and these rooms are very, look like something out of the 1600s. Now, it's all right if you want to be a nun and go in there and take, you know, believe you're born to Christ and all that, and that's fine. But these are guys. And it's Rome, but it's too far to walk any place. So they're looking around, and then suddenly the heat goes off. Mind you, this in January. And so I walk in a room. I've never laughed so hard in my life. There's my brother in one bed. He's got a pillow wrapped around his head with a belt holding it, and he's got all of his clothes on and extra clothes on, and they went around all the other rooms. We were the only place, people in the nunnery, and got all the blankets, these little tiny thin blankets. Maybe that's part of what the Catholicism about today. Freeze to death and you're closer to God. Yeah, if you die, I guess you would be. And so so I go into my room and there's nothing left. My other brother had taken everything off my bed. Like, Gary, you can handle this. Just meditate. That was the last thing he said before he laughed and went to sleep. And so I'm walking around, just enjoying the place all night. So if you have a chance, visit another country, visit some of these places. Get out of the tourist area. Don't go to the tourist areas. And just enjoy how wonderful, beautiful, and caring people from other cultures can be. Anyhow, the study published in Journal of Cellular Physiology showed that tomatoes can interfere in stomach cancer cells, and key processes related to cell development and migration and proliferation are inhibited. So here's the takeaway message. Tomato extracts can induce apoptosis, which is programmed cell death. The cancer cells died. That should be in all of the research out there, but it's not, but it should. And for you, those of you in this audience who love berries, fresh or frozen, doesn't matter. The article says that berries are good for your brain. Now, we're making so many berry juices here. Whoa, everyone here at this anti-aging clinical study is drinking 15 glasses of juice a day. And I created different juices depending upon what I want to happen to their DNA to rejuvenate it and turn off inflammation in the body. And it's really helping them. I'm seeing such incredible changes in just 2 weeks. In fact, I asked the exercise physiologist to start tomorrow and all day tomorrow and all day Saturday, do a second physiological exam, range of motion, strength, endurance, all the stuff we did at the beginning, which I filmed, by the way, and I'll show it all to you when it's all done. But every day, you, everyone listening, should get strawberries, raspberries, blackberries, cranberries. They're all rich in anthocyanins. Cherries are good, too. And the deeper the color, red, purple, the blues, the healthier they are. And they're rich in these antho, A-N-T-H-O, cyanidins, C-Y-A-N-I-N-S, anthocyanidins. And they cross the blood-brain barrier to become localized in areas of the brain related to learning and memory. And in the brain, anthocyanidins decrease the vulnerability to oxidative stress that occurs with aging and reduce inflammation and increase neurological signaling, your neurons signaling one another. So when they looked at 16,000 women over the age of 70 participating in the Nurses' Health Study, it showed that berries can help affect the aging brain. So that's great. So more berries you take in, and berries are low in calorie and they're a living food, and juicing berries even more potent, or taking berry powders, that's the most potent of all. Also from Cedars-Sinai Medical Center, this is based upon the Mayo Clinic proceedings. When you're low in serum calcium, you have a greater increased risk of sudden cardiac arrest. All right? Heart attack. And it can be fatal in over 90% of the time. So, look, get your calcium every day. Calcium citrate, magnesium citrate. Take in 800 milligrams. And that'll do you a lot of good. And by the way, the Journal of Epidemiology and Community Health shows that the risk factors for heart health is linked to the marital ups and downs. So let me just put this in a way that is probably easiest to appreciate. The available research points to an association between how argumentative, how contentious, how emotionally volatile your relationship is. And if you're in one of those relationships, you have a greater risk of dying of a heart attack. So, remember that. So this whole idea, yeah, we're in a bad relationship, but we're going to, you know, do something about it. Yeah, how about end it? And by the way, from the Feinstein Institute for Medical Research and New York Medical College, Mediterranean diet, once again, is more effective cure for acid reflux than medications. So sticking to a Mediterranean or healthy plant-based diet is just as effective at controlling reflux as medicines prescribed to millions of people every year. But you wouldn't know that, would you? Because the ads on television show someone eating something they shouldn't and being smacked by a pizza or whatever it is, and then they take an acid reflux and they're fine. No, you're not fine. You've just turned off hydrochloric acid, so therefore what do you think is going to happen to the food or the nutrients in the food you just ate? You're not going to be able to absorb it. And you're going to have all that dumped into the intestine, only partially digested, which can then leak into the intestine with leaky gut syndrome and cause a hyper-stimulation of your immune system because your immune system cannot distinguish between, let's say, a partially eaten piece of food that gets brought into it and a bacteria or virus. That's one of the reasons to really take your time when you're eating, masticate properly, or juicing, and that all helps. That's the latest on health and healing. We are 26 minutes into our program. We're going to take a brief break and come right back because I've got a lot to share with you about the environment. I'm going to honor Hillary Clinton today with a little clip. Okay, so this is Honor Hillary Day because remember I said a year ago she's going to run again? I have a lot of sources. Well, she's going to run again. But no, she doesn't want to. She's resisting. She, you know, she's had her turn. She wants everybody else. Oh, my goodness. You really want me to you really want me to run? Yeah. No. But right now, I believe that anyone who has a cute pet dog could win the presidency against Trump. Remember I said, just leave the man to his self and he will self-destruct on every level, in every way a human being has ever done? Well, that's happening. But I'll give you the other side of that story in a moment. I'd like to welcome all of you. I'm Gary Null. Do you remember I said a year ago that we will, for the first time in our history, experience Category 6 hurricanes? We did. This is from Scientific America just this week. Quote, Hurricane Dorian was worthy of a Category 6 rating. The Category 1 to 5, the Saffir-Simpson scale for rating hurricanes is inadequate. Quote, Category 5 Atlantic hurricanes are rare. Only 7% of the 243 hurricanes observed since accurate satellite measurements began in 1983 have reached that catastrophic intensity. And it is truly exceptional to see a Category 5 hurricane as strong as Hurricane Dorian, which powered ashore on the island of the Grand Bahamas September 1st, with sustained winds of 185 miles an hour and gusts to 220 miles an hour. Winds of this strength would make Dorian worthy of a Category 6 rating. So, that is the new norm. We're going to be seeing not just the category with the winds of 220 miles an hour. I saw what it did to my home and sanctuary, animal sanctuary in Florida at Category 4, only 2 mile an hour under Category 5. And that was moving at about 12 miles an hour. This moved at 1 mile an hour. And the one over Houston, it wasn't a heavy category, but it was a heavy rain, 5 feet of rain. And there's no place for the rain to go. So it sits and permeates everything. That's the new norm. So just be aware of that. It's here. Also, there's a push in the United Kingdom. We have people all over the world listening to this show. So for those of you in the United Kingdom, my suggestion is challenge what you're being told in the media, that the human papilloma vaccine is important and everyone should have it, children, even seniors over 60 years of age. And of course, the truth is completely different. All you had to do is a little research. So let me share you the research. The person telling you this, being quoted as the expert, is the president of the International Papillomavirus Society, Professor Margaret Stanley. Okay. And she thinks it's great, and she's promoting it. Why am I concerned? Because I always look at the backstory. I pull back from everything before I make a decision and look to see what might be mitigating this interest at this moment when I don't see the scientific literature supporting the human papilloma vaccine as being safe at all. In fact, not only does it not show that it can prevent cancer of the cervix, if you have cervical cancer, it can make it worse. That's the study. And in fact, there was a French, just last year, a French oncologist, Dr. Gerald Delpini, and he said that the Gardasil vaccine was actually associated with an increased rate of cervical cancer among patients. In his research, and it was not spent out there, it was not put out, and it should have been, but what about if people have a conflict of interest? So did anyone take the time to look into Professor Stanley's background? They praised her. They reported on her everywhere. She was appearing everywhere. But here's what we found. Professor Stanley is a consultant for three of the companies that manufacture and market the human papillomavirus vaccine, MSD, SPMSD, and GlaxoSmithKline. And if that information is not heavy enough, she is also the human papillomavirus expert for the Human Papilloma Vaccine Subcommittee of the Joint Committee on Vaccines and Immunization, United Kingdom. That's the committee who has been put in place to advise the UK government on vaccination policies. So, I wouldn't believe a single thing she said based upon this rampant conflict of interest that she has. And when they say there's no adverse effects, well, we took a look and we found 95,010 adverse reactions related to Gardasil, including 495 deaths. So you can't find any, and we find this number, and ours is legitimate, and that's based upon how few people actually report on adverse effects. So they want to attack those who question vaccines, and we're asking them, show us the proof. And they don't have proof. They have opinion and financial interest behind them. Now, I've given you two stories recently. I shared a story about Greta Thunberg and her message. Now, if you have a problem with her message, then share that. Share a scientific citation that something she has said is inaccurate. Because what she's been saying is actually very accurate. What's the problem is that behind her is a large group of people who are going to make a lot of money if they can control the money being spent by governments around the world. And that concerns me because that is not legitimate. That is called the new green capitalism. So yeah, they're going to say green like Al Gore, green, 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 green. Solar, solar, solar. And yet it's all about the money. So I've tried to make this relatively simple. There are three types of environmental organizations. First, there's the bright green environmentalism, and it holds an ideology based upon the belief that the convergence of technology and social innovation through the tech sector, the business sector, major corporations and government working together, there's Cortez, provides the most successful path to sustainable development. They seek radical change, but all within the neoliberal capitalist frame of growth. So they want to tell you what to do, but they don't want to stop doing what they do. They want to continue flying their private airplanes and eating Colby steaks and buying stuff they don't need. Now, the largest proponents of green energy and bio-nanotechnology and electric cars, these are the bright green environmentalists. I wouldn't believe a thing they say, nor do I trust them. These are the enemy, in my opinion. Then you have your light green environmentalism. They see protecting the environment as the foremost collective and personal responsibility. They focus more on environmentalism as a lifestyle choice rather than a political stand, and do little about seeking political reform. Okay, that is both a pro and a con. Let me explain. I believe that we will never in our lifetimes get to a place where the government or industry does anything meaningful to change anything. It can't. It's been captured. The people behind it, those wunderkinds who show up at the Council on Foreign Relations, the Bilderberg Group, the Trilateral Commission, the Business Roundtable, the American Chamber of Commerce, these are people who want to keep control. Power is very important to them. They share their energy with other people, so it's like large clubs, and you're not in it. But they'll talk a good game. Now, they're not going to change, so therefore I believe that like the light green environmentalists, you have to start change yourself. But on the one hand, they'll say, well, you can change all you want. You know, if you don't eat any meat, and if you, you know, don't buy genetically engineered foods, and if you go to a local garden and in your neighborhood and, you know, pick some tomatoes, that's good. It's not going to change anything. That's not true. It will change. Not if a few people do it, but we have about 8 million Americans right now who are engaged in a healthy vegan or vegetarian diet. And now we're spreading that consciousness with articles and documentaries and broadcasts like this and lectures. And it really can get into the school system, because then you can have an enormous impact, and that's why Greta's important. Though I believe that she'll be steered right away from all these suggestions, and the neoliberal agenda behind her is going to manifest. I've given you all the names of the people, the foundations that George Soros controls, Bill Gates, Bono, and these other boneheads. They're the ones who are all over this. How do you think someone gets to meet the Pope one week, and you know, and then every major government in the world opens their doors and she goes in there and yells and screams? And I believe that last time she did it was purely theatrical, and because she's an actress and she's an agent and her parents are actors and performers and her family's all actors, and she grew up being taught how to act, you know, how to use her emotions to convince people of a particular point of view. Okay, it doesn't denature her message. It just makes, let's throw up the shrill factor to scare more people. You're not going to get young people change because of fear. You can get young people to change if you're a model yourself and you show them what they can do. What can I do today in my home? What can I do at our school? What can all of us in the school do? Well, go vegan. Good. Let's start promoting community gardens. Let's all work each day in a community garden for after school project. Good. Let's start buying our food from local farmers and have them grow it organic. Good. Those are things that are doable. Let's start planting trees. Let's have a GoFundMe and plant 1 million trees for this small town in Indiana. That's doable. But it's not doable if you think that what should come is the government. The government is the beast. Least I remind you, the National Defense Authorization Act by Barack Obama allows the government, without ever explaining itself, to arrest you, torture you, kill you, and be held non-accountable. That's the power that psychopath put into place. And yet, he wears a beautiful tie, and he's smooth, and he shoots a basketball. So, my God, why don't we just write him a check for $20 billion and say, please, can you just shut the hell up for a moment? Because we've had enough. The answer is no. Why give him 20 when he can make 40 billion? Unmitigated greed and the psychopathology of power have corrupted every institution in America, every single one. The churches are corrupt. No, they're not, Gary. My pastor tells me they're not, because we gave him $86 million, true story, so he could be higher above the clouds and closer to God to pray. Well, that makes sense to me, right? My God, could you imagine if he was trying to pay in a subway? God wouldn't hear him in a subway then, would he? Wow, how dumb can we get? So the government's not going to help you. The government is the problem. The government's the number one polluter in America, the military. Have you seen any candidate? Of course you haven't. Do anything about the military-industrial complex, including Bernie Sanders. No, give them everything they want. Give them a blank check. Hold them non-accountable. Let them create bombs, wars, kill people. Who cares? Clearly, we don't, because there's been no protest. Not a single person come to the street and say, look at the children in Yemen. But those are not our kids. They don't count. They're over there, some dark-skinned kid. Now, knowing what a racist nation we are and our institutional racism, that shouldn't be a surprise to anyone that our military-industrial complex, with all these absolute sociopath generals, admirals, these ass-kissers, are the ones in power, and no one ever challenges them. In fact, Sean Hannity, I think he gets down on the ground and kisses the floor in front of their, while they come up their street. The only person on television who's had the courage to say what we're doing wrong is Tucker Carlson. I don't agree with much of what he says, but on this I do. He brings in a guy who's a colonel, and every single thing out of that guy's mouth about why we shouldn't be in any of these countries, and why the military should not have all this power, and why they shouldn't be told, asked to do anything, because everything they've done has been wrong. But that's the lone exception. Left and right. MSNBC and NBC, they're all pathologically dysfunctional. I don't believe or trust any of these people at all. I don't trust or believe in any institution. So those of you who believe Cortez and these other people have, unfortunately, great enthusiasm and not a whit of common sense or real-world experience in dealing with the environment, but they're all suddenly experts. Yeah. Let's see how that works. So you've got to take it upon yourself because no one else is going to. Then you have your dark green environmentalism. This is more radical, anti-consumer, the Gaia theory, humans' alienation from nature, the resource depletion, etc. And they see industrial capitalist civilization as the main problem of climate change. I would agree. They're absolutely correct. However, I also disagree with the Extinction Rebellion. First of all, I know who's behind it. I know what their motives are. They're promoting heavily the Internet of all things and smart cities, the people who've controlled it. They're on those boards. I gave you that yesterday. So that they can't deny because it's their own writing. But now they've got young, more idealistic people taking the streets. If you went to London and you lay down in the street and you suddenly cause someone to be 3 hours late because it takes six police to lift one person, that's how many are assigned. First, those police are not going to be available when acid attacks are occurring and knife attacks all over London. And secondly, what does it say to a person who's in a car, just a regular person, man or woman, going to work, and they're going to be late? Now, they don't know necessarily about the environment, and they don't know what your ultimate ideal is, but you've disrupted their life, and you're angry with them because now you're not going to convert that person. Whereas had you taken a more reasoned approach, had you gone into the schools, had you gone into the churches, had you been invited in and made intelligent presentations, had you shown and shared the scientific literature, had you shown films about acid rain, the bleaching of the coral reefs, the whales starving to death because they don't have the krill, because the water's too hot, the krill died, and the food chain extinction occurring, had you shown that the bees are dying, and without the bees, one in every three foods cannot be grown because the pollination's not there and the depletion of the insects? Had you really educated people, you could have motivated them. Getting them angry is not going to allow them an opportunity to appreciate your message, even when your message is right, but your method of jamming down people's consciousness is not going to work. So that's one of the things I see is wrong with the environmental movements. Now, the trouble is people assume that big tech, you know, those wonderful spiritual meditative guys that will go out at lunch and have a green juice and come back later in the day and they'll over at Google and Amazon, nothing like Jeff Bezos and his mistress having a wonderful yoga session, a hot session together. They should do it actually naked in front of the whole Amazon community and everybody could applaud them for their openness. And yeah, no. You don't have nice people out in Silicon Valley, right? You have massive exploitation of people's wealth and an environment. I was just power walking this morning with one of the guests here, and he's from the middle of California. And he said growing up in the 1940s and 50s and 60s, it was beautiful. It was everything. It was paradise. Everything grew. And he said now nothing grows. Everything has been taken over by tech people, and they paved over everything. Overdevelopment is everywhere, and the cost of everything is so high that unless you're wealthy, you can't afford even to rent, let alone buy. So these are the people you're asking. Greedy people are insecure, so they got to overdo everything. And now they're supposed to be the ones who save the world? No, they're the ones who've caused us to have the technology that is causing us to deplete the precious minerals for our cell phones and our 3,000th cell phone in the last year because someone said there's something new and we got to have it. No, we don't. And remember, there's one thing, like you have a consciousness that the environment's going to hell. In different places, it's already done so, but it hasn't happened to you yet. So we go into cognitive disconnect. If I haven't been hurt or adversely affected by the environment, I doubt that I will, so it's not the big deal in my life. It should be. Well, that shows who we are. We've disconnected from the commons. We've disconnected from emotional and spiritual values that we should be sharing. We disconnect from the idea that part of life should be service for others who are not able to handle something at this time in their life. So shouldn't we be the people that help them? If they're hungry, give them food. If they're homeless, give them a place to stay. But we can think it. It doesn't mean we actualize it. So here are some climate groups that I do not support. They are the most ineffective. And these are the greenwashing ones. Alliance for Climate Protection. That was founded by Al Gore. And it's connected with Newt Gingrich and Pelosi. That should tell you a lot. Climate Action Network, that's the umbrella group for NGOs mostly connected with the UN and the Bright Green Solutions. I haven't seen them do a damn thing that's helped anybody but themselves. Climate Reality Project, that's founded by Al Gore so he can make even more billions than what he has now. Conservation International has ties to British Petroleum, Cargill, Chevron, Monsanto, and Shell. But boy, those are great companies. They're green, aren't they? Isn't Monsanto green and organic? Don't they want you to eat healthy foods and put natural sprays like cayenne pepper? No. And they've even threatened indigenous peoples off their lands, and such as the Bushmen of the Kalahari in Botswana and Papua New Guinea and elsewhere. The Earth Charter Initiative. Good intentions, yeah, nothing else. The Environmental Defense Fund, greenwashing group, ties with McDonald's, Walmart, FedEx, energy company TXU, big supporter of natural gas and fracking to replace coal, has ties to natural gas companies. Forget about it. Global Footprint Network, all corporate-friendly greenwashing. Green Cross International, founded by Gorbachev. Would someone go and just erase that little thing? Here we're going to do a little paint over, but there's essentially nothing except give awards and some assistance to people who are affected by natural catastrophes. My God, of 833 awards given this week to Greta, tell her parents, Gorbachev's group will give her award. All right, anything for an award in the photo op. The Natural Resources Defense Council. A lot of close ties to corporations, Silicon Valley, and who better is a moral character than Elon Musk and some of these people, right? God, if Steve Jobs were alive today, he had a wonderful personality for a tarantula. And Wall Street. Now, how could you be against any environmental group that believes in Wall Street, and Wall Street believes in them? That's just natural synergy, right? Wall Street, let's just take a look at the people running Goldman Sachs and big banks. They have only your interest at heart. They actually go every night. They go to a church someplace and give to the poor. That's what I heard. Yeah. The Sierra Club. Forget about it. Yeah, forget about it. World Business Council for Sustainable Development. Nice gig if you can get on it. Doesn't help the environment. World Industry Council for Environment. Nice word. I like the title. Rolls off your tongue well. Yeah. World Industry Council for the Environment, no thanks. The World Resource Institute partners with governments and corporations. What could possibly go wrong? World Watch Institute, started by Lester Brown, but embraces the big green model. Forget about it, Lester. Have a reincarnation. Come back as authentic. Worldwide Fund for Nature. That really sounds cool, doesn't it? Like, woo, just go out and pick some four-leaf clovers. Put them in your hair. Formerly the World Wildlife Fund. Uh-oh, that's the world's largest environmental organization with 5 million supporters. Well, that tells us a lot. Often accused of greenwashing, such as its cooperation with Monsanto, Coca-Cola, and the whole list of corporations I just have here in front of me. Of course you're going to be into health and nutrition and children's gums and teeth and children's normal weight and pancreas healthy if you're with Coca-Cola. So keep doing what you're doing. World Wildlife Fund. Oh, yeah, and all those villagers in India that have been claiming that you raped them. What could go wrong there? So just understand something. The only thing the media is ever going to promote are people who are connected to the inside of everything that they have been told is good, and they're not making any moral decisions because they'd have to first be moral to make a moral decision. The reality is, I wouldn't have anything to do with any of those groups I just mentioned, and yet they will control 100% of everything going forward because they've got the kids up front. Oh, how cute, look at her. Oh, my God, I'm in tears. And then write your check today for carbon footprint amelioration. Nothing will change in the environment, but will make us all feel kind of good. As the waves are increasing, Miami is sinking. Who would know? The IQ will actually increase on the East Coast if South Beach disappears by at least 23 points. What are you talking about, Gary? I'm just having fun. Sitting here talking to myself, I entertain myself this way throughout the day. So they should never let me out of West Virginia. So moderately, I think they're coming to get me. Moderately ineffective, these will, they make some important contributions. The other ones made none. Like Bill McKibben's 350 organization, it doesn't have much to say for solutions, but for educating people about climate change, it has done a lot of good. And McKibben is more pessimistic than bright green, but nothing happens. Citizens Climate Lobby, a main group James Hansen is involved in, but completely focused on carbon emission reduction, and I don't see that as being the primary issue. And First Earth, very radical, perhaps too radical to be effective. It's been good in bringing awareness about the dangers of genetic engineering on environment, and it's very weak when it comes to nuke power. A lot of these people want nukes as clean energy. Well, nukes are not green and they're not clean. They're deadly and they're toxic. And if you doubt me, then do this. For all of you who believe, like Barack Obama and Ms. Cortez, take a trip to Fukushima. Spend a week there. Forget the, you know, space suits and the hazmat suits and the radiation. Because if you're really into it, you're going to say, well, hey, this thing went off 8 years ago. It can't be deadly today. And no, educate yourself. Friends of the Earth, that's started as a splinter dissident movement from Sierra Club because of Sierra's positive stance on nuclear power. So forget Sierra. But Friends of the Earth has been strong in opposing meat consumption. I support them on that. And its carbon footprint. Again, they're right on that. I support them. The original publisher of Die for a Small Planet, Francis Moore LePay, and it was my publisher also. Betty, the publisher, was deciding who should do which book. I did Protein for Vegetarians. She did Die for a Small Planet. Well, they've been successful in eliminating billions in taxpayer subsidies to corporate polluters. And for that, they are really good guys. So I really support Friends of the Earth. And the Extinction Rebellion is contributing to increasing climate change awareness, if nothing else. But again, the main criticism within its legitimate, more productive environmental groups is that it's drawing funding away from more legitimate groups. Greenpeace was one of the first to really oppose GMOs back in the mid-1990s when it first started. No, aside from the false press, Greenpeace opposes nuclear power. Just a few more here. the National Wildlife Federation, it's okay with wildlife protection at the local levels, but it barely addresses climate change. The Rainforest Alliance has been successful for protecting rainforests, and for that, that is terrific because we need protection of our rainforests, and they're doing a really good job, Class A for the Rainforest Alliance. But there's been controversy over certification process for sustainable agriculture in fair trade movement. Also, Wildlife Conservation Society, mostly to conserve last wild places on Earth. And then the best of the best, with the greatest integrity, the Center for Biological Diversity. They're really helping to protect endangered species. The Earth Justice protects and promotes laws to preserve natural resources. Its board is mostly made up of Native American voices and conservation attorneys and the leaders of local environmental groups. There's no corporate representation. So Earth Justice, the Center for Biological Diversity, two of the best. Born Free in the USA is the protection of endangered mammals, started by Virginia McKenna and Bill Travers, who starred in the classic wildlife film Born Free. Deep Green Resistance, I have a lot of respect for them. They're more radical as a group in the view of the mainstream media and other environmental groups. It takes philosophy from the deep ecology movement, like David Abram and Chris Hedges and Richard Heimberg, from Post Carbon Institute and Jerry Mander and Vandana Shiva. Very good group. And then two more, Survival International, started back in 1969 to protect indigenous and tribal peoples and uncontacted tribes and their lands from corporate colonization. Five stars to them. Great transition, mostly a think tank of visionaries and progressives that have inspired Bhutan's prime minister, Thinley, yeah, and the global network of several hundred scholars and intellectuals and civil society leaders and activists working to develop visions and pathways for a great transition to an uncertain climate future. So there they are, the best of the best, Center for Biological Diversity, Earth Justice, Born Free USA, Deep Green Resistance, Great Transition and Survival International, and the ones I would not do anything with. But unfortunately, the best of the best would probably be the last of the last to get a penny when the green capitalists take over, slice and dice up everything. And that's why the people invited Greta to Davos, so they can say, we're for the environment, and we're former presidents, and we're heads of corporations, and we're heads of banks and International Monetary Fund and the World Bank and European Union heads. Yeah. And you're the problem, not the solution to anything. I'm Gary Null. I'll have more on upcoming programs. But I want to thank you all for listening. Look forward to sharing more on our next program. Have a nice day, everyone.